Okay, so today we are joined on a wonderful panel setup by Joanna Town, Prema Mehta, and Declan Randall. Thank you all so much for being here. I was going to do a little biog for each of you, but that's people aren't here for me to ramble on. So I wonder if we could maybe start off with just a little bit about you and your background and how you got to where you are now, really. I don't know if Declan, do you want to? Well, we'll start with you. Throw you in at the deep end there.
Great. This is payback for me putting you in the deep end on my session, isn't it? Good. Hi everyone. I'm Declan. I am a lighting and set designer primarily. I dabble in projection design, but we don't really talk about that. I am also now, for the past a year and a half, I've been full-time at ETC as their training program coordinator, so that sort of keeps me busy outside of the design work, or rather the design work keeps me busy outside of ETC is perhaps how I should phrase it, in case they're listening to this on playback. So yeah, I've been designing for about 23 years. You can tell from my unfortunate accent, I'm not from this neck of the woods. I'm originally from Johannesburg. I've been in the UK for about 11 years. And I've been fairly lucky, I think. My job has taken me all over the world, and I've managed to work in theatre and architecture and film and TV and fashion and pretty much everything. So it's been fun. You more than that? Oh, and I've just finished a new project while we've been on lockdown. I've resuscitated my 3D printer and I've printed a whole bunch of cookie cutters, theatrically themed cookie cutters, which I will be selling. So you can have stage managers and Fresnels and AJs, and also I'm going to post it on my social media so you can see what they will look like. But that's been my project. So there we go. Yeah, that's me.
That's brilliant. I love that everyone else is sort of turned to like sewing and stuff, and you've gone, do you know what people really need? Cookies.
Cookies,
like
absolutely.
Good choice. Good choice. Prema, what about you?
I don't know how to follow that. I wish I went first now and then it would have got better. hi everyone, I'm Prema. I work as a theatre lighting designer. I trained at Guildhall and have been a lighting designer for 15 years. Perhaps it's important to throw in the sort of awareness that when I left Guildhall, I went straight into lighting design. So there's obviously pros and cons to that, but started out in fringe venues and pub venues and kind of just kept climbing the ladder, if you like. So I largely light for dramas now, a couple of musicals. I think over the years I've sort of let opera go by, not deliberately. I think it's just part of the process of I don't know, the AV checks that you get take you in a certain direction. So largely drama and musicals, and obviously as a freelancer I've kind of had the privilege of working across the UK and with a handful of artistic directors, I think. So that's quite a lovely thing, depending on the way you view artistic directors.
Brilliant. Joe, what about you? You've got an even different route again to that.
I have, yeah. I mean, blimey, I started follow spotting on the North Pier in Blackpool when I was still at school, and that gave me the bug to work in theatre. I still remember climbing up the side of the theatre, which was on the edge of the pier, and you climbed off a cat ladder with the waves and the wind just blowing you off this cat ladder, and then you crawled along the roof and went through a hatch into the follow spot areas. How they ever got away with that is unbelievable. You'd literally climb over the side rail of the pier just to get onto this cat ladder. So I was doing that at 14. I went for an apprenticeship at the Royal Exchange Theatre, which was fantastic. So I've come up through the apprenticeship route with the Royal Exchange and ABTT, and I'm really pleased that over the last 5 years apprenticeships have come back into their sort of place to start. I would never have done well at drama school or college education, so apprenticeship was absolutely perfect for me. And because I fell in love with working in theatres and buildings and making work rather than creating work. I ended up remaining in theatre for another 20 years before I went freelance as a light designer. I moved to London when I was 21 to be chief at the London Bubble Theatre, which I did through the summer months, which toured parks with a big, big top tent and a generator. And I learned all about petrol and diesel and putting spikes in grounds to stop everything tripping out. Sometimes we'd literally just be standing there pouring water onto these spikes so that nothing tripped out while the shows were running. In the winter, I was the chief electrician of Operetti, which is now English Touring Opera. So I did that for a few years before becoming head of lighting at Liverpool Playhouse. And at Liverpool, the head of lighting lit all the shows, and that's when I started to look at being a designer. So I lit all the shows in the main house and the studio space for 4 years before moving to the Royal Court in London. So coming back to London, I was at the Royal Court for 17 years, went through its refurbishment and its rebuild. I was going to leave just before that happened. Then I thought, this is an opportunity that over all these years of working within a building to put everything you've learnt back into a building just couldn't be missed. So I ended up staying for much longer than I expected. But it was fantastic to be part of a creative architectural team and put that together. So I actually only went freelance as a light designer in 2008. Which classes me as still a young lighting designer, still finding my craft and my trade. I don't know whether I can get away with that, but I try. Yes, I've been freelance ever since. Keep busy. I work in mainly rep theatres and a lot of fringe. I really love working with new directors and designers and creating new writing. I think that's just an influence from the court, really, just being the person that puts the label on a show sometimes for the very first time, I find really exciting. And I suppose I should say I'm also chair of the ALD, and I've been chair for 3 years. When I started, we had the Save Stage Lighting campaign, which was a busy old time campaigning and shouting a lot. Now we have this crisis, which also means campaigning and shouting a lot. So I'd love to just be able to have a drink one day. That would be nice, wouldn't it, Prema? I think you feel the same sometimes about that. Let's just all just go and have a drink and a chat. But I really hope that I'm helping try and make it the ALD a younger and more active association to be part of. That was my goal. And I think we're starting to slowly make steps to make that work. Anyway, I'll shut up now. That's enough about me. No,
it's brilliant. Thank you. So obviously we're here to talk primarily about colour and sources, and what is something that's, I suppose, quite a technical thing in a way. But I'd like to kind of go through the process, really. I'd be really keen to hear how you first start having those conversations about light on a show and the way that it might contribute to the actual sort of storytelling of the piece, especially really early stages with a director and designer. I don't know if Declan, you come from quite a unique point of view in that you sometimes tick more than one box in terms of role. So I don't know if that's something that'd be quite interesting to hear, how you approach those conversations.
I mean, one of the things, and I think it's changing, but it's always sort of traditionally the lighting designer was the last person to come on board with the team. And normally at that point, all other decisions have been made. So your role tended to be more reactionary than creative. And I think that's one of the reasons, aside from the fact that I'm a bit of a control freak, but I think that's one of the reasons why I like doing set design as well, because you know that you're having the right conversations from the starting point with the director, and it all sort of ties in, you know, together. That it doesn't. I think it's getting better now. People seem to be saying that they're being roped in earlier and earlier and earlier into the process, which is great. It's the way it should be. You should be there really right from the get go. But it's always an interesting thing because I find light is one of those things that's really hard to talk about. If you say to someone, "I'm going to paint the wall sky blue," everyone knows exactly what that wall is going to look like. If you say, "We'll have a sky blue wash of light on stage," their eyes glaze over. They just can't see it. So it is a weird thing. It is about finding a language. And I think one of the things, actually, rather than talking about what the light is going to do, it's better to talk about the way the light is going to feel, or the way that it's going to tell the story. So instead of saying, you know, "I think we'll have a blue wash here with a little, I don't know, steel green from the side or whatever, and just because it's me, a gobo coming in from somewhere," it would be easier if you could say to someone, "You know, I think what we need to do is we need to balance the light levels to make sure that we're really capturing the loneliness of this scene. And to do that, I think we can cool it down and shift it and maybe put a little bit of something into shadow." I think that seems to be, for me, a more interesting conversation. Yeah. I always tell, and I apologize for anyone who's heard this before. I was having a meeting with the director. We were doing a play, Strindberg's Dance of Death. And in conversation with the director said to me, "Oh, I want the lighting to be like the dunes of the desert." And I was like, "Oh, that's cool." So my immediate thing, I'm thinking color, because that the immediate image that sort of popped into my mind is like, oh, sort of, you know, ambers and golds and that sort of thing. And it turns out that wasn't the reference at all. What he meant was he wanted the light to be continually shifting and changing like the dunes of the desert. Okay. So nice image, but in itself, not enough information. You've really got to be prepared to sort of dig down a little bit and trying to find out what they actually mean, because it's such a visual medium. Something like Dunes of the Desert for me immediately put a visual image in my mind, as opposed to something that, you know, that equated to time.
Yeah, definitely. Joel, what do you, how do you approach those starting conversations?
I think Declan's reference there to putting an image into people's minds is really important. So, I mean, colour to me is one of the first things that I think about. It's what goes into my head as I'm reading a script or looking at a design. Colour is the thing that changes location and emotion for me, and I use colour rather than the angle or direction of light that other people might use. So it's the shifting of colour that creates those emotions for me. But trying to describe that to a director and have the same vision is always the hardest thing, because some think they have a very clear vision of what you're talking about and are very pictorial. But in fact, when you dig deeper, you actually find that their image is completely different to your image. So you've got to make sure that you get those two images to line up. I think it's really important to use physical things to do that, whether it's nature or films or photography or artists, to try and make sure that before those dialogues start, you have a commonality of what you see things as and what those pictures are. Really important what Declan was saying there.
Yeah. Prema, when you approach, I mean, as you said, you do loads of drama and musicals. I mean, do you find that those initial conversations are different when you're describing the, I suppose you would say, the involvement of light? Do they differ genre to genre for you?
Yeah, I think broadly speaking, you could probably go wilder when you're doing musicals, and there's an expectation of sort of perhaps not just creating one language. And yet with dramas, it feels like wherever the location takes you, you are ultimately telling one story. So it feels like, you know, I remember being at Guildhall training and lighting opera scenes as part of my final year. And an opera director, Martin Lloyd-Evans, said, "Don't change the language," even in opera, actually, don't change the language too much. And that was probably his aesthetic. So I think certainly there's more scope, having just lit Fame, you know, big musical, you can get the lighting elements really into the scenic elements. It can feel like it's much more of a statement. And yet sometimes you've got dramas and you've got to play a bit more, not always, but sometimes a bit more of a supporting role in terms of supporting location, supporting emotion. So I think whilst obviously every production is going to be different, there's always mentally, I think if I get offered a musical, I know it's going to fall into that remit and the opportunity there might be bigger. The number of cues will be larger. And with dramas, it feels a little bit more like you're reacting to the scene, you know, and you're taking it bit by bit, supporting location, etc. And of course, with musicals, you've got the whole, you know, it sounds very obvious, but supporting the music, supporting the beat of the music and what that's trying to tell and the style of that. So maybe there's a bit more flex, especially potentially in terms of colour. I think you could go a bit more wilder in musicals.
Yeah. And when you start a plan for something like that, I mean, this is sort of something I want to ask all of you, but I mean, when you're starting a plan, what do you have a thing that you always start with? You know, some people like to start with, I don't know, a front cover, because then they know it's in there and it's done and the ball's rolling. Do you have a start point?
It's up to me, Rory.
Yeah, yeah,
I can tell you that I absolutely end with a front of house cover. It's probably my least favourite thing, so I leave it to the very end. Aideen Malone actually glanced at one of my lighting plans. I think we were both working at Aura together at the Academy of Live and Recording Arts, and I was there in focus and she was there prepping for the next show. And she walked into my focus session. She said, "Prema, you really come in at all angles. I've just spotted your lighting plan." So I guess it's quite interesting, despite telling you that I work largely around drama and musicals, I did a fair bit of dance at the beginning of my career. So maybe the background in dance helps me to think about angles a lot more. Mm-hmm. And it's really interesting hearing Jo talking about how she thinks in colour. Actually, I think I think in direction and angle. And I think for me, colour may come secondary or perhaps instinctively, but I feel like I see in directions.
Yeah, that's really funny, because one of the questions that I had sort of later down the line was exactly that, which is, do you start with a unit that you then colour up, or do you go, I know that I want this colour scheme to be involved, now let's pick some units? Because I think my personal thing is like you, Prem, I go for angle and what it's going to do, and then go, right, now I need to think about what I want to say.
I'm with Joe on this one. Colour's always my first instinct. This is really interesting. For me, absolutely colour, because it's a response to having read the script and knowing what the story is and what, you know, those sort of things. And a lot of it, if I've come in slightly late into the process, is a response to what the set design has presented. Mm. So there's a fair amount of colour in there. And I would say my shows tend to be quite colour heavy, not necessarily colour saturated, but lots of variants and things that I can sort of build and sort of, you know, play around in. I have had some unfortunate colour experiments in the past, which hasn't worked quite so well, which we might get to. I'm with Joe. I start, colour absolutely is my starting.
Do you have a starting point?
I mean, I say starting point. I mean, obviously, you know, you have to tick the boxes. You need to make sure that your front light's in and your back light's in and your side light's there and all that kind of that. But within that, while I'm sort of plumbing in a backlight system, I go, oh, that might be nice if it's in, I don't know, 79 or whatever the case may be. So it kind of runs in tandem, I think, for me.
Yeah. What about you, Joe? What's your starting point?
Well, my starting point is definitely colour, then creating the angles within that, because different pieces require you to use dramatic lighting or specific angled lighting. So I put everything on my plan. I put that's beauty of technology now and electronic drawing. So I may put two sets of front of house in. I may put two sets of top light in, three sets of side lights to get, and all the key lights I want to be in specific colours. to create the effect I want within that scenic element. And I will put everything on the plan. And then I work out whether it will fit, whether it's technically possible, whether it's tourable, all those other elements, and work out what is most important to me and what colour can do more than one job. And then I start clawing away at everything until I have something that is workable and usable. But it starts with opening all the doors and letting everything in. And I do look at angles, but they always are probably pretty keyed in a strong colour. When I say a strong colour, I don't mean a deeply saturated colour. It could be a particular tone of pale blue that just has that edge of something else in it that just twists it so that it's not quite what we all think it is. And that's what I play with, is colour pushing us into another direction that we don't emotionally know why that has done that, or why that piece of scenery is looking quite that colour when you think it's got daylight on it, because of shift, just playing a little bit with the the toolbox is so big now, there isn't a selection of daylight blue. There's hundreds of daylight blues toning us in different directions, whether we're angry, happy, sad, you know, it's still a version of 201, one might say, but is not. And I find that absolutely fascinating. And the fringe venues that I love working from, the small companies hate me because I will, you know, have one piece of colour in a lantern for a specific reason, knowing that they've got to buy a whole sheet of jar. So I have a wardrobe full of colour, which I take with me everywhere so that I don't have to buy that whole sheet for that one piece of colour.
When you're talking about like putting all your ideals on a plan and sort of playing around with that quantity thing, when it comes to like picking unit choice, I'm really interested in how you all do that. I mean, sometimes that's determined by a tech spec and what you've got, but how do you go at it? So especially in your case, Joe, do you go at it with it needs to do X, Y, Z, or do you go at it with, you know, this has to be a source four?
I think I go from it has to achieve the job I want it to achieve. So I use very generic symbols to start with for the same reason. So I know that I want that to be a 2K wash light, or I know I want that to be some sort of HMI type source, or I know that I need this to be a wide unit or a narrow unit. So I literally fill the plan with generics, with a generic symbol, but I then go, right, I've only got 12 source 4, 19 degrees, and I've put X number that I need to be narrow. So what is important there? And then hone it down from that. But I use, so I'm thinking about what the light is, not what the unit is, not what the manufacturer of the unit is, but what type of, you know, is it Parcams, is it a wash light, is it a profile, what type of profile? Does that make sense?
Yeah, no, completely. What about, I was going to say you two, that makes you sound like the terrible two there. What about you two, what do you think? How do you go about making those sort of initial choices on units? I don't know if either of you. I'll let you both fight out who wants to go.
Go for it, Prema. You were unmuted first, so jump in.
I think I'm quite an economical designer. I think that I tend to look at what the tech spec is and what's available to me, and I've got an awareness of the budget. But I'm quite frequently aware that the lighting budget's titchy tiny. And I think it's so interesting hearing processes. I don't think we actually get the chance to do this ourselves, but I think I can see the imagery in my head very clearly, but I literally sit there with the tech spec before I put on any lighting fixture onto my lighting plan. And I just think that's what I want. I can see it, which fixture from the tech spec is going to serve that brilliantly, and where will that go? So I literally work off the tech spec first. And having said that, you know, quite early on, we've had conversations about the early process, but I'm really heavily influenced by a set designer and what they bring, and I love being part of that white card model. So all of my thoughts are around responding to the set, and I see that very, very clearly. So, at, you know, what sort of angle of light I want to bring into that set, how can I support the set, how can I support the colour of the set. But I was just thinking back to a show that I did at the Royal Court. I think it was, I don't know if it was, oh, was it Super Ho? That is the name of a production, but I don't know if it's that one. But anyway, the production manager became the sort of set designer. It was all a bit last minute, if you like. And he painted the back wall in this pale pink. No, I've got it wrong. He painted it in a pale blue. And I, of course, put a wash on it for a particular moment where I made it become a tint of sort of pale pink. And it was brilliant because the reviews picked up on it and they said, you know, set against the pale pink background. And Marty Moore, the production manager, was livid with that. He was like, what have you done with my set, in a really jokey manner? But it sort of needed to be set in that typical school girl, young child sort of bedroom. And I thought, let's go from there to then going outside and we'll go into tungsten. But it's just quite fun how actually the power of light and the power of colour can have such an influence on scenic elements and costume too. So yeah, that's a good way to wind up a production manager. I'm not sure I'd dare do it to a set designer.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, presumably though, like you mentioned there about looking for the thing on the spec that serves it best. I mean, colour is such a funny thing, isn't it? Because there's colours that you put in a 5K that you'd never put in a birdie. Or like, you know, like that, we talk about colour and the colour choice, but actually unit choice and colour choice kind of, in some cases, go kind of hand in hand, I think. I don't know if that's the thing that you find, but
I also wonder, Rory, how much of this is unconscious, and that's not a very helpful thing to say when people want to know about processes, but does it come from instinctively just knowing? I think it does to some point. That's, yeah, I don't know how helpful that is.
No, I agree. I completely agree, which is sort of, this is why it's really interesting to have a sort of group of people talking about it, because I think that, as you say, we never hear each other's processes really. So we all, as you say, you just sort of know in your head that something doesn't work or you shouldn't do that. And maybe everybody does the same thing, but you just, because we never discuss it, it's not something that we ever hear about, do we?
I do think that you have to be very careful about how you, those choices you make, because I mean, it's interesting Prema saying she comes from, I look at the tech spec and then I make the choices from there. I, from having put all my ideas down onto paper, I still have to honour the tech spec and the budget and everything else. And what's interesting is what you do with that 5K in that angle. Is it, does it have to take the deep blue because that's the one piece of kit that will allow that to happen? Or do you put the piece of 201 in it that can then be cold and warm and give you two jobs for the price of one? Those are the big decisions you've got to make as you're honing down the kit bit by bit to get the ideas out that you want, because often you don't have enough kit, and what the colour and the kit do together are equally as important.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, one of the things, I don't know, Declan, if you have any thoughts on this, but is how you look at all of that together and then go, do you know what, no, we do need to hire something in, or you know, you get to a point where you go, actually none of this is what I want it to do, and even, you know, the best color in the world is not going to do the flexibility or something that I'm looking for. I don't know, is that something that you have much?
I guess to a certain extent. I mean, when I was sort of starting out, I used to do a lot of work at the various sort of arts councils and things that were back in SA, and they all had sort of, you know, repertory rigs installed, and they were fairly based, they were pretty much based on the sort of German opera house kind of bridge L1, L2, L3 yeah, psych bar kind of, you know, sort of system. So a lot of my approach, I think, is still sort of focused around that kind of sort of process, because I was always used to having something somewhere that would probably do the job. And then once you move out of that environment, then those choices, you know, because you assume that in a rep rig you get there and that 2K is there because that is the best light to get that shot from that position. And then all of a sudden you find yourself in a situation where you're having to make those calls and those choices. And I think that it's, I've had some fairly substantial arguments with people about this, but I think you have to, as a lighting designer, you have to know what the equipment can do and what it's capable of doing. I had a thing once where which I suppose it was a bit mean of me, but I was mentoring some students, and there was a young student designer, and she hung up they were busy rigging. There was a Fresnel that went up, and you know, I always sort of have banter, and we'd sort of do like a sort of question answer thing in the student sessions. I was like, oh, okay, tell me, what's a beam angle of that Fresnel? And they didn't know. And I was like, well, how can you rig a light that you don't know what it's going to do for you? That for me is absolutely fundamental. And some people, you know, and the response is, but it doesn't matter. I know it can change size. It'll probably be okay. And yeah, it probably would. And it absolutely was. So, you know, again, there was a little bit of instinct attached to that. But I think you have to know, for me, lighting design is absolutely a fusion between art and science. And the you have to marry those two. You know, you don't have to be absolutely up to speed on all the latest networking, IP, A, B, C, Q, Z knowledge. You can tell I'm on top of that. You know, that, you know what I mean? It's, you don't have to have that degree of technical knowledge, because there is always a team around you that can help and support. But when you're the one who's making decisions, and you're the one who's putting your creative offering on the line based on those decisions. So it's in your best interest to absolutely sit and go, right, what can this light do? And like Joe says, if I put it in, is the choice, do I, because it's a 5K, make this the deep blue because it'll cut through, or do I put a lavender in it and then it acts as a warm and a cool, or a 201 that could, you know, all of those sort of things come in. And Premier, you were saying, I don't know, sometimes you just make decisions, you don't know how you make decisions, but you just go, yeah, that'll probably be fine. And sometimes it is, and there is a fair amount of instinct, I think, attached to it. But, you know, particularly with color, and certainly more so now, you know, if you make a wrong color choice, it's not the end of the world. You can probably change color. Mm-hmm. Okay, it might cost you, you know, a little bit of postage and another sheet of gel, perhaps, if it isn't in the venue, but that's kind of the worst thing that's going to happen. Yeah. You know, so for me, color is the area where I think experimentation is kind of fine. Where you're experimenting with fittings, I think you're potentially going to get yourself into sticky water, because if you make a choice and put something somewhere and it's not right, and it's now behind a set and there's no ladder access, and all of a sudden to change that becomes a lot harder to do. Mm-hmm. And I've veered off topic completely from what your original question was, but that's because I forgot what your original question was.
No, you're fine. I think it's so funny. You say about the knowing about the degree of the Fresnel, and that it'll probably be fine. And all four squares all just smiled and laughed as people who found out that once upon a time it wasn't fine at all. We've all been in that situation. I'd be really interested, especially to do with this sort of the light and science thing, like we said there. When you approach a project, how do you consider things like lighting for different skin tones? Because I feel like it's something that we just don't talk about enough. Occasionally we ask each other, but I mean, it's,
you know what,
a really important thing.
I mean, you're right. Skin tone is absolutely a concern. And I think to a certain extent, growing up in South Africa put me in a slightly more fortunate position, because I was absolutely guaranteed of having a variety of skin tones in almost every single show that we ever did. So you kind of get used to it. I mean, the one I remember having a conversation with somebody once said, oh, the easiest thing to do when you've got different skin tones, just use 201 because it makes everybody look equally horrible. And I was like, well, okay, that's an approach, I suppose. I mean, you can, yeah, all right. So yeah, do you know what? I think for me, and again, maybe this is historical, but I am far more accepting of the fact that there are different skin tones and that people appear differently on stage under different lighting conditions. I'm kind of used to that. And I think it's a trap that sometimes it's essential, but I would be wary of trying to make sure everybody looks the same and everybody has the same amount of light and all that kind of thing, because we're telling stories. We're mostly telling stories about real people in real situations.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, just embrace that and, you know, take it on board. I mean, there are things you can do. We did this, there was a play where it was quite an intimate moment, sort of lit with a single sort of candle on the table, no other light. And it was a white actor on one side and a black actor on the other side. And, you know, when you're trying to create the sense of that sort of, you know, the candlelight being the only source. And one thing we actually ended up doing was painting half of the top of the table white. The audience couldn't see it because the stage was, it was a flat auditorium, the stage was raked. But just to get that little bit of extra bounce up onto face and into eye sockets and things like that, hugely helpful. But that's not going to be an every time thing. It's, you know, it's having a few little tricks and tips up your sleeve like that, that you can go, well, let's just, you know, put a bit of a reflector there or something there. I think the introduction of LED technology has actually made that slightly easier, because we can fine tune color now to a degree we've never been able to before. So if a particular skin tone needs a little bit more amber, not a problem. We can ramp that up. If it needs a bit more red, we can, or too much, you know, there's degrees of things that we can manipulate now that actually makes that easier. But I would still be nervous of trying too hard, because I think you run the risk of either flattening everything out to the point where it just becomes working light, or you're going to end up with hundreds of cues as somebody moves from stage left to stage right. And I've got to rebalance all those intensities as they're sort of going across the stage. I think you're just asking for trouble. You know, there may be moments where you go, oh, actually, we could probably use a little bit more light or a little bit less light, as the case may be, whatever it is. But yeah, I don't think I've never found it as tricky as it is. I find warmer tones help generally with skin. I find tungsten, and that is why I'm so sad that we're losing, or one of these days are going to lose tungsten, because it just does pick a skin tone, any skin tone, pop a tungsten in, and you're good to go. Open white, thank you very much, and job's done, you know. Yeah. But yeah, that's my 5 cents worth on it.
Well, I think Declan's got a lot of good points there. And the thing about skin tones is that we've been dealing with skin tones, I have, for all my career, because everybody is different. Doesn't matter you've got the bald actor, you've got the ginger haired actor, you've got your Jamaican actor, your Indian actor. Everybody's skin tone is different within the community we're working on, just as their costume is different. Or they're in the set, is that we have to consider colour for everything we're doing, and what light is best on the quality of what we're working on, whether that is the colour of the costume to the colour of the skin. And trying to balance that between everybody is the hardest point, I think. And making that colour choice, you have to think. I sit in the rehearsal room and watch my company and think about the costumes before I completely decide what my colour choice will be. And if I, just using as a general example, if I want it to be a sort of daylight 202 sort of scene, and I don't want there to be a lot of green in the light, because green does not work, it doesn't bring out the skin tones on anybody particularly well, and I want everybody to feel cheerful and comfortable, and it's a comedy, then I will use Roscoe. I will use 372, because 372 has got the red in it that I need to tone that the way I want. And if I'm doing an angry drama, I mean, I'm using words very specific, you know, generally here, then maybe 202 and 201 is the better option, because that's giving the edge that I want it to have and want the audience to feel emotionally about that piece of colour. Mm-hmm. So we have to make those decisions the whole time. And I think we may have got a little bit lazy. And I think the arc sources have been a big contention. If we'd stayed with tungsten and went to LED, I'm not sure we'd be having quite the discussion we're having, but because we went through the very green arc sources for a while that made everybody look terrible and made most costumes look terrible, then we would, you know, I think they've caused a bit of a stir. And I think poor quality LED didn't help at the beginning, and I think good quality LED is absolutely ideal for exactly what Declan was saying. I've done a lot of work at the Royal Exchange in Manchester, and their general cover is completely good quality LED. And you can literally have a conversation between two people happening of different skin tones and adjust the two LEDs to make that work for that scene without having to worry about, in the next scene, two people being in a different location and having to, you can constantly be changing and tweaking within that general cover, which is absolutely brilliant. But we have to be aware of that the whole time. We have to be aware of what our angles are and how we're getting into people's eye sockets and how we're allowing people to see faces, express the words that they want to. I mean, I do a lot of drama, so it's all about expressing words for me. That's what I deal with, words. And if people can't engage with those words, then the play's lost, I believe. Yeah. So it's all very important.
Yeah, I think the angle thing is really interesting that you say there. It's a really, everyone talks about colour particularly, but actually angle is a big thing, which is probably a good thing to come to someone who comes from at all angles. Prema, what I'd be really interested in, you know, we spoke there about like arc sources and stuff, but you are what I'm lovingly calling our resident candelographer. How do you find, obviously, I mean, you don't really have any, presumably, much in the range of colour choices when you're dealing with candles, or do you? I mean, do you?
Yeah, Rory, it was so interesting. So I was offered to work at the Globe at the in the Sam Wanamaker space, where the rules are just candles. And their reason for bringing me in was that I was a lighting designer, which was just really ironic. And I was like, but I don't know anything about this the tools that you're offering me. But, you know, it's always good to have those moments of working on a project where you're completely out of your depth for whatever reason. And for me, just changing all of the tools made me feel a great sense of nervousness and yet excitement as to what we could create. In terms of colour, I think I'm going to link this back actually, because I did a lot of learning at the Globe. I had to really go back almost to school to kind of find out top tips. And it picks up on a few points that Declan and Joe made around how light reacts on skin in a way. So what we certainly found, if I come back to colour in a moment and just talk about light on skin, the bounce of the candlelight was actually really quite beautiful and really so easy on actors who were of a certain age. So the older the actor, somehow the more beautiful their skin glowed under candlelight, which was fascinating. And then, of course, there's a conversation around how, I mean, the first show I did there, that was, they really threw me into the deep end. It was an all women of colour production. So the actresses were already walking around and they were already saying, oh, well, what's the point of doing this? No one's going to see my face anyway, and rah, rah, rah. And then they had me, and I was pretty new, but we just kept reassuring them that they would be visible, don't worry. There was something really important about the angle of the light, the angle of the candles, the intensity of the candles. It almost took you back to your basic principles of lighting. And then when it came to colour, really interesting, because I didn't know all of the rules, I was quite capable of breaking them. I mean, obviously I had to keep within my limitations of making sure everyone was safe, and there's a lot of rules there, rightly so, around no hairspray, I don't know if it's as far as deodorant, I don't think that's quite right, but there's something about what you can and can't use. And a very different way of working, just that everybody's always got to be looking out for someone else and literally watch your back. Mm-hmm. But there was something really interesting for me around experimenting, not necessarily with colour, but just with techniques. So could I choose a different position? And a very specific example is Swive. So I went back there to light in the same space with Ben Stone's designing, and Ben, as a set designer, his aesthetic is just beautifully clean and crisp, and it was gorgeous. And then there I came in with a bit more experience, because it was my second time in, and I was really clear about needing certain angles and how he had to work it into his design, which you know, I don't think Ben would mind me saying, we were a new sort of, we were developing a new collaboration. It was a brand new script. Ben and I had never worked together. I was a little bit more experienced in working with candles. Ben was new to working in that space. But I think it's also just knowing what battles to kind of pick. And I knew that, for instance, on Swive, footlight was really, really key. Not necessarily related to colour, but I'll try and get there eventually. But footlight and mirrors, really clever mirroring angles. And, you know, that really helps lift up the light and help to fill in the shadows of the eyes. So really clever techniques, which I remember Ben coming up to me in tech and saying, Prema, I get it now. I get it. I thought, thank goodness you've come on that journey with me, because it needed a little bit of negotiating. But in terms of colour, I was the first time I was there, I was really quite naive. And I think that actually was quite a good thing. You know, I was able to go in and say silly things like, well, what happens if you put a massive piece of gel in front of that candle? And of course, the production managers would be like, no, health and safety. But what came from that was, but we can use Perspex. Would you like us to order you a piece of Perspex? And here is a sample, much like a swatch book. And we can get it in tomorrow. Which one do you want to pick? And the variations, so similar to a swatch book. And I was able to pick that colour, get it ordered in, and then it was about positions of the candles in relation to the Perspex. Yeah. And the bounce of that and the reflection of that. So I think, yeah, I think there's something so, so interesting. It was like going back to school, but really worth learning.
I imagine it's quite overwhelming at the start as well, like you say, that first time.
It was horrible, Rory. I didn't sleep for a week. I signed the contract and then I thought, oh no, this might be the end of my career. But thankfully it wasn't. But yeah, and I think even prior to tech week, there was literally a sleepless, I mean, I don't sleep well during production week, but the week before I'm usually fine and no chance of sleep.
Yeah. Well, you should have lit a candle or something to calm you down. I don't know. If we go to the complete other end of this then, you know, we're a bit like Joe said, we've gone through a sort of a range of technology to get to where we're sort of coming to now with good LED. I mean, and now you go into venues and you've got bad LED, you've got good LED, you've got tungsten, you've got discharge. You can have all of these things. I mean, obviously it's a nightmare trying to match all those things. But do you ever find that your colour choices are dictated by that? You know, you just can't mix all those things to it. So you have to alter where you go with your idea. Do you ever find that as a thing?
I mean, to a certain extent. I mean, I just want to pick up on the one thing you said is, you know, how do you sort of match everything? If I'm dealing with different light sources, then I don't try and match. I use them and I take advantage of the difference. If otherwise, you're just opening up a whole can of heartache for yourself if you try and sort of get stuff in. And, you know, particularly everybody always says, you know, oh, we've got color pickers on the console, whatever console, they've all got sort of some sort of filter swatch in them. I know I want 201. I go, that's not 201, or it's 201 on that, but it's not 201 on that. And it's, so I'm not overly bothered. If I have a range of different fixtures, the key for me is that your systems are the same. So if I have a front light system, that system needs to be the same kind of fixture. you know, I can have one system front of house could be, I don't know, a Source 4, and the other could be a Cantata something from, you know, way back when. It doesn't matter, as long as the system is complete and the same, you can kind of, you can deal with it. So I don't, you know, I'm less concerned about sort of getting everything to match. Mm-hmm. And then just following on from that, the reference to the sort of filter pickers and the consoles being different, for whatever reasons there are for that, I'm also not one to sit and make and sit and go, well, that's not 201. I'm going to sit and fiddle and make that a 201. I'm not interested. I've got a couple of markers within that color filter picker that I use as a reference point for myself, so I can gauge how well the light is going to respond to that color picker. Mm. And I'll quickly step through those and I go, oh, that's nasty. Okay, so ignore that and just pick something that's more or less close to what you want. Or, yeah, okay, this light's actually pretty good. And then you can try and, you know, yeah, be a little bit more sort of malleable about it. But it's, and, you know, the other thing with 201 is, or you're picking color, I don't know why I keep going back to 201. But, it, you know, everyone, it seems to be default. Everyone just presses 201. That's like the default go-to button to see how well a light is dealing with color. And I've completely lost my train of thought. The problem is color is all relative. So it depends on, you know, how accurate you perceive that 201 being. Depends on what you were just looking at and what you were just doing. And are you expecting 201 in front of a tungsten source, in front of a daylight source? Are you expecting 201 in front of a 2K or a 575? Or have you just been looking at a red scene, in which case that 201 is probably going to look more like a 117? There's all of those kind of things that sort of factor into it. So for me, the balancing things is less concerned. It does it look right now, and the whatever I've used to get there is a useful reference perhaps, but yeah, I'm not overly concerned. In fact, I actually quite enjoy having different sources on the rig, because it gives you a different light quality. I mean, tungsten does what tungsten does, discharge does what discharge does, LED does what that does. I quite enjoy fluorescent as a light source. I don't get to use it often enough, but when you do, it's fabulous. I love working with fluorescent. But you use it because it's different, not because I want it to look like something else.
Yeah. Joe, that's one of the things we've spoken about previously. I mean, about, can you give me 201 or whatever it is, 200, give me 200. And then you turn around to the program and you go, well, that's not 200. And they go, no, that is 200. And I feel like in the rise of LED, we've certainly people who LED has been their primary thing to come into the industry, we all have these opinions of what, you know, it's not exactly a Pantone system. We all have opinions of what 200 is. How do you cope with that?
Well, it's really tricky, isn't it? Because even I question it myself. I started when more theatres had good quality LED, which you found could come out of the desk quite well and be quite true to the real colour on a white wall. I started taking my own palettes with me, so mm-hmm. having mixed these colours, and then of course you go to the venue and you start a scene and you go, that's not 201, and they go, well, it's the one you gave me. And I go, really? And then you have to remember that, of course, you are looking at different set, different costume, different faces, and that all makes a difference. Now, that doesn't really help with what we've been saying about picking colour for tungsten units, but I do think we cheat our colours because I tore my LED 100% 201, and my reference to 201 in a tungsten unit is in a 575 Source 4. That's what's in my head. That's what I know works at 50%, 70% in that unit, which is very different to what it's coming out the desk as well in an LED unit, even if it's technically correct, if you see what I mean. So I think there's so many elements we have to play with. It is quite good having your own colour palettes for just ease of a starting point and saving on programming time. But I don't think there is now ever going to be a true colour. And you could say that anyway when we had tungsten. No colour is true because it varies on the unit that you put it in every time.
And of course everyone perceives it differently as well. So,
sorry, Declan?
I say everyone perceives it differently as well. So what you see as 201, an audience member, did they know what they were looking at, might see it as something else.
Absolutely, because not everybody has 100% true colour vision either. You know, we have to remember that.
Judging by some of my colour choices, I would put me into that category firmly, I would think.
So it's a very difficult medium, I think. I personally don't like discharge, and I put the units there to do certain discharge jobs. I never try and make them do anything with a bit of colour. I know that they'll do good dark blues. I know I can get a strong red out of them. I know I can get a beautiful clean cold light out of them. But I would never try and make them do anything that they're not really designed to do, if you see what I mean. That's when I want to use them for those jobs.
Do any of you ever feel completely stuck when it comes to making a colour choice? I mean, whether it's on the hoof in tech or it's on a plan, I mean, do you ever just go, like, I've got to commit to this thing and I just don't know what to go for?
I've got two sort of rules that I put myself under regarding colour choice. The first is, if I can't decide on a colour, then no colour is always going to be my starting point. If I can't decide, you know, unless it obviously needs to be a deep blue or something, but if we're working in sort of tint world and I can't decide what it's going to be, my default will always be open white, because within that, assuming again we're on talking tungsten here, because within that I've got a huge range. It can be quite a nice bright white, clean white, and it can be quite a nice sort of warm murky amber. And then once I've had a little play with it, I can go, oh, okay, yeah, it probably needs 201 or whatever the case may be. And the other thing that I always do on every show is I will always make sure somewhere in the rig is a color I've never used before. Just A, because I'm learning a new thing. It's rare that I would bet something on it, so it probably won't be of colour in my front light system.
Why not? But,
well, you know, hey, live on the edge. but you know, it's somewhere there'll be and there's always green. I love a green. I can't help myself. I have to have green. So there's always green in there somewhere, in some shade or tint. But there's always a colour in there I haven't used before. So that's kind of my three.
You see, I thought I'm different on my default than Declan, because I will put the colour in that I'm not 100% sure about, that I want to try, that I've not tried before, or I'm not convinced about. I'll put it in knowing that I can make it open white. So I go the other way, you know. Yeah. Well, I can always tell them to just pull it all out, so that's fine.
Yeah. There was a wise woman that I had as a mentor once, who may or may not be in this call, that once said to me, when it comes to colour choices, you know, if it's something that you're really worried and the gig is like absolutely crucial, go with something you know. If you're in a studio, you can run up a ladder and change it yourself. It's very easy. And if you're doing it at like a drama school or something, you have a whole team of people who specifically are there wanting to do a colour change in this rig. So take the risk, you know, as it goes along, take these bigger risks. And it's stuck with me ever since. Prema, do you ever do that? Do you ever just chuck a total curveball of a colour in?
I do. I think similar to Declan, I always use at least one fixture in a new lighting gel, just because, again, I think it's good learning. I was thinking back about my process, and interestingly, I did say that I started out with angles and fixtures, and actually for me, colour. Although instinctively I know the answer, colour, gels are the last thing that go onto my lighting plan. So, you know, it feels like we lit ages ago, doesn't it? But prior to the pandemic, I think the final lighting plan I did was for The Winter's Tale. And I remember it being 2 days off the deadline of, you know, it being due in. And I have to admit, I'm not one of those people that develops my lighting plan throughout the whole period of rehearsals. I'd much rather just sit down in a few days and just do it, or a few evenings. And I got to the point where I put all of my fixtures down, very confident about that. All of it felt really good. And then there were a few fixtures where I got stuck on colour. Not all of them, but a few. And there is something great about taking the time to just sleep, to process that. And then you wake up the next day and you just know instinctively that's what the colour needs to be. Mm. But I think I've learned over time not to get frustrated, because for me, there's always that moment of getting a few fixtures going, oh, what colour should this be in? And don't get frustrated with it. Just step away, either do something else or fall asleep, whatever it is, come back to it. And I think the answer's there. That's how it's worked for me anyway.
Yeah. There are a couple of questions come in here that I'd love to ask you. So one of them is about when you start with a colour, and this is particularly sort of in LED land, do you start with the sort of syntax of like 3/something or 5/something in the desk and work from there? Or do you ask a programmer to have a sort of bank of their favourite versions of these colour palettes as a starting point?
I always start with the 3/, and then I go, oh my God, that's never going to come out of that fixture. And then I asked to stand at the dials, because I can't bear going a little bit more of that, a little bit more of this. Oh, no, stop. Oh. I just want to mix it myself. And if I could have a little row of encoders in front of me all the time doing that, I'd be very happy. I start from the desk, and then you learn. And then often you'll go, if you're working with a programmer, you know, they'll always give you the next option that's their option or somebody else's option that they've got on their in the desk already. Mm. And it's quite interesting. A lot of house people now have, of course, the colours for all their units in the desk as well. Mm-hmm. If I at the Royal Exchange, I would start with the house version rather than the 3/ version.
Yeah.
Just put it in there.
This person has actually replied saying, Joe needs a light hack. Now, I don't know what that is, but I mean, I don't think it's rude. I think it just is something that would help you in the dials option.
So yeah, light hack is, you can find it on the ETC website. It's a third party, basically, set of encoders. You can, it's a little kit that you can build yourself, and it USBs into your laptop or into the console, and it gives you two little encoders.
I need someone to buy me one for my Christmas present, I think.
Buy and build, just because it comes in a bunch of pieces.
Well, that's Christmas Day there, Joe. That's sorted.
Sorted, yeah. Christmas and Boxing Day sorted.
Yeah.
Air fix days.
The other thing that's coming here, sort of continuing on from something you said earlier, Declan, do you have things that, like a certain gel or a colour palette that you just keep coming back to and you always have in your rigs? I mean, I'm going to aim that at Declan and his green first, and then we'll spread out.
So yeah, I do love me a bit of green. There's always green. I do tend to use quite a bit of 728 steel green, which is one of Rick Fisher's colours. I love that colour so much. I really do. I'll throw steel green in any opportunity. Actually, I might want to revise that, where I said I might make something open white. I might actually make it 728 as my starting point. I went through a phase, I hopefully I'm not still in that, but where I was quite liked dirty lighting, and I would try and find dirty colours and always try and get it quite gritty and grimy and, you know, that sort of thing. So, I don't really have any favourite blues. 715 is quite nice. Cabana Blue's got a nice amount of red in it. But yeah, I try not to have, although I've just said that I do, but I try to not be as obvious about consistent colours as, you know, just because I think your job is to respond to the story, to the moment, to the piece, to the set, to the costumes, to the everything that's going on. And yeah, you may absolutely have some particular colour combinations that work and that you know will always, you know, be your get out of jail free card. But that feels slightly lazy to me, and it feels slightly dishonest almost towards, if that's the right word to use, towards the production. I remember a few years ago in my office. If you remember, Lee Filters issued like a sort of concertina thing that used to flap down, had little sort of windows of all their colors. And I had this hanging in the office of my window, because why wouldn't you? Because the sun used to come and it was lovely. And three colors used to fall, sit next to me, and used to land on my desk. And it was 728, 767, I think, is wheat, whatever wheat is. I might have got the number wrong, 767. And 704, lily, I think. It was three of them. It was a lavender, a yellow, and a green. And these three colors, they just looked so lovely together, and it was so pretty. I thought, I'm desperate to find a production where I can use these three colors. And eventually one came along, and I thought, okay, well, I'll try and shoehorn these colors into the show, and let's see what happens. What I didn't realize is that the sun had bleached those colors somewhat, and the lovely three pastel shades that were sitting on my desk was not the hideously garish color combination that popped up on stage in the first tech session. I was like, yeah, do you know what? Can we take a tea and I'll just whip those out and we can then, you know, start again. So, yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Prema, do you have a starting point for color particularly that you know?
Do you know what, Rory? I don't think I do, but I think I want to go back and just answer. Declan made me think of a couple of things that I probably should confess to. When I left Guildhall, that early start of your career where you're not quite getting enough jobs, and I reckon Roscoe either hated me or felt really sorry for me. I'm pretty sure it was the latter. And they wanted me to create a single swatch book from all three of their swatch books. So what did we have? We had E-Color, Super Lux, oh God, what's the other one? Super Gel?
Yeah, I think so. Roscoe Lux Super Gel, yeah.
Roscoe Cine Lux Super Gel, and they do a Storaro range for the cinematic stuff.
So that's right, Declan. But I had the first three, and I had to, literally, my job was to put them in chromatic order. So, I mean, that's a nightmare, isn't it? I think Joe referred to the hundreds of blues, but let me tell you, there are 300s. And at the beginning, it was this amazing, exciting thing. And then my living room was just absolutely, there was no carpet to be seen. There was just swatches. And at one point, it tipped me over the edge. I just couldn't hack it anymore. And I asked for a pay rise. I think I got every member of the family involved in the process. But I think, yeah, in a very practical sense, I'm very, very steered by not having a palette, not having specific colours. I'm very steered by the set design, in particular the costumes. So, and I think in truth, I get bored quite quickly. So that's a nice way of exploring new colours. Mm. I have got a slight confession. I think when I lit a show at Guildhall, I managed to, I think, light a show pretty well. And I had a bit of Lee 789, blood red, in the rig. And it became a superstition. So for the first few years when I left Guildhall, I would order it in and put it into a single fixture, and it wouldn't ever be switched on. I don't know if I should confess that now, because obviously that's money. But it was like a superstition that I had to have that light in the show and it'd all be fine. And then when I sort of found my confidence and thought maybe I'm getting away with it and I don't need to put the 789 in, you know, in the rig for the sake of being there. But I like to think, yeah, I like to think I sort of just react to what the other collaborators bring in terms of design.
Yeah. You see, it's the boy that cried wolf now. Next time you need that and you actually need it, someone's going to be like, no, we've heard about this.
I've never needed it since, thankfully.
I remember doing a session once, Richard Pilbrow. I was doing a masterclass and Richard Pilbrow was one of my sort of guest speakers. And I'd just done this whole long session about the science of color and reflection, absorption, and how you choose colors based on that. And this whole thing. And Richard gets up and says, what I do is I undo the little bolt on the swatch book and just drop it. And then I look and see where it lands. Whichever looks nice, I just pull those together. I was like, thank you, Richard. You have just completely smashed an hour and a half of colour science.
Brilliant. That's fantastic. Yeah, it's like opening the colour. It's the more like our equivalent now. It's just open the colour picker and just touch, isn't it? Yeah, gosh. Prema, you sort of touched on there about collaborating with other people. I mean, do you ever feel intimidated when you're talking about colour with a set designer? Like for me, like, and it's so ridiculous because this is what we do, but I'm like, well, colour is so their thing. I'm like, art is so their thing. I feel really, when they say, what are you thinking? Or you're throwing ideas out there. Do you ever find those colour conversations hard with other collaborators?
I think I'm quite grateful that there are no set designers on this call, but I'm aware that it's being recorded at the same time. You know, just as we say that part of our job is to find the language with the directors, and I've always thought with directors, it's not their job to be able to know how to talk about lighting. If they can and they do it very well, that's a bonus. Mm. But if they don't, I mean, directing is a skill in itself. So it's my job to kind of extract what it is that they want the lighting to look like. And of course, our set designer colleagues are brilliantly creative and quite capable about talking about colour. And yet I'm not sure I've had enough conversations about lighting colours with set designers, and that may just be because they're talking about larger, broader terms of visuals, and they're not getting into the nitty-gritty of colour. Mm. But I mean, unless I've forgotten, because we've had a couple of months off, I don't think I've ever gotten to a deep, detailed conversation about lighting gels and colour with a set designer. But I, you know, of course I know when if I get it wrong and we're in tech, I know and I'll note that that's completely wrong. And equally, what's really lovely is when you get the set designer just turning around and going, that colour looks really beautiful. And it's like, thank you. So, yeah, I don't know. I mean, I'd be interested to hear about Joe and Declan if set designers really have a detailed conversation with you about colour.
No, I don't think I've particularly had big conversations with set designers. I know there are set designers that have opinions, and those conversations are definitely had, but not in a big not in a dictatory way in any way. I've been given sets that set designers have gone, I don't know how you're going to like this. You're not going to be able to put any colour on it, and you go, watch me. We'll see what happens there. I did have a full set of yellow once, yellow walls, yellow floor, and it was really interesting what worked and what didn't work on it, actually. And I was surprised at how much did work on it. So that was, I mean, luckily, again, that was a drama school production, therefore we were able to play as much as we wanted with it, which was fantastic. No, I think I've had more conversations with directors than set designers, actually, about colour. They're more worried about what to do. I mean, I'm about to light a show that is 50% of the cast. They're all monologues, and 50% of the cast are people of colour. And I have to, and you know, one of the three directors gave me a long talk about colour, of which I corrected them in a few ways about what they think works and what doesn't work. So that was a good debate. I think what does happen now more than it used to is in techs, directors and set designers discuss colour. So they will come up because they've seen the reaction of moving lights and LEDs. Now they can go, can we look at all of this in red, in green? Could that be more blue over there? And they expect you to be able to switch it on like that, because that's what they're seeing happening. And of course, only a third of the venues are actually the venues that you're working in that have that amount of equipment that you can just click your fingers and change the colour and have a look at it. So I find there's a bit of frustration now coming in with the rest of your creative team when you go, well, we could do that maybe tomorrow morning and show you then, or we could, it's like, well, why can't you do it now? You know, what is the issue? So I think there's a misunderstanding of how flexible we can be with colour is creeping in because of the LED issue. Yeah. So that's partly moving it off on a tangent. But
no, you touched on something there, though, that is really interesting, because, I mean, last year was like you had a different pandemic to deal with, which was, all walls, all ceilings, and all white.
Me, yes.
It seemed to me that you had a sort of run of shows that were all walls, all white, and all ceilings. How, like, as you say, you know, watch me. I'm gonna use colour. How do you, How do you strike that balance between, like, it's going to look different on the person to the massive shutter cut behind them? I mean, does that terrify you, or are you just so used to it now?
I'm not quite sure I understand the question. Because you said, are we talking about colour, or are we talking about...
Yeah, so I was just thinking that, like, obviously you're basically in, like, a complete white box, that everything you do is going to be amplified massively. And obviously what it looks like on a person is very different to what it looks like behind them on the spill. And is that something that you consider while you're doing something with, like, a white set, for example?
I think I'm very bold on my walls, actually. And I would probably spend a good 25% of the rig lighting the walls in order for them to then be able to contrast with the actor, if that makes sense. So it's really important to me, it's important as part of the storytelling to shift the colour within the whole set. And some shows really call for that and others don't. So the GIF that I did this year, in fact, which was white and was for Eclipse Theatre Company, it was really important to get the actors to stand out against the white walls. So we did a lot of strong 201 through the windows to gain that sort of grayness, that bounce on the set. So even though, so the white walls, funnily enough, were sort of brighter, but that also allowed them to become a tone of their own. Mm. But then, even though you were blasting an awful lot of light onto the actors, there was a balance between the two. The actors needed to be brighter, but the eye had to make sure that it felt like it was naturally coming off the room, not by being lit from the front. Because also when you're constantly doing white sets with roofs, everything's coming from the front. So making sure it's not all flat and dull is also incredibly difficult to balance out. So colour is useful in that respect as well, to either take the walls away or bring them into the fore. But on the GIF, because we were sat mostly in a living room, also playing with the tone of those colours. And I did the same on the Watsons, was when the whole scene had to be, the scenes had to be completely white because they were inside the book. It always looked white to the audience, but it was either slightly grey or slightly warm or slightly green or slightly pink, and emotionally and psychologically there was a shift, but that shift was very small to the eye. And I think the beauty of, you have to engage and you have to embrace the white set and bring it on board and wrap your arms around it going, I'm going to love you and I'm going to make the most of you and not shy away from it. That was probably the easier answer.
Yeah, no, that's interesting.
Just touching on what you said there, Joe, I think, you know, you're talking about the audience always perceived it as white, even though it wasn't. And I think that's particularly color-wise one of the things that's really interesting. And I find you do it, you probably subconsciously a little bit quite early on, but you manipulate, our eyes will always naturally try and find the white balance of something. And you can completely fool the eye into thinking that something else is white. And it can actually be quite a saturated color. We do experiments with students where we do ranges of pinks and ranges of blues, and you end up with quite a saturated, almost a sort of 1-2-8 pink, a sort of like really vivid pink that they are convinced they're looking at as white light, because that's their point of reference. And it is exactly that, you're constantly getting your eye to readjust. You're going, okay, well, if I need you to see that as being white, that needs to be something else, whether it's its complementary color or a deeper shade of the same thing, whatever it is. So there's those constant shifts that you're doing to fool your eye all the time into establishing that white balance. And it's hard to do, but when you get it right, it's remarkably satisfying.
Mm. Yeah.
Exciting though, isn't it? I lit the effect in Frankfurt earlier this year, set in a clinic. So early on, we knew it was going to be a white set. And then we were talking about almost damage limitation. How do we make this safer? And we got to a point where we were just saying, no, actually, let's go for it. High gloss floor, high gloss back wall. And I remember, I mean, you know, it was in Frankfurt as well. So you had to get on a plane and get over there and all that waiting time. And I literally said, I don't know how the light's going to behave in terms of bounce. And again, maybe I'm talking about angle again, but in terms of bounce, I just did not know how that would behave. And actually, it was an utter blessing, because what you had was bounce, which actually looked like textured gobo against the other surfaces, and it was beautiful. And yet I can't pretend that I knew that would be the case. I knew there'd be some form of bounce. I guessed in which direction. I didn't know if I would need to do a lot of cancellation work on top of it to try and style it out. But it was absolutely beautiful. So I think when I started out, I was sort of warned off white sets. And then, of course, I've got given an opportunity of high gloss, white everything. And it was really, really exciting once we were in it, but daunting before.
Yeah. I actually quite love them. I just wish they'd stop putting roofs on them. That makes it really difficult. Yeah. I've had four white sets with four roofs in the last year. But there you go.
I also find...
I'd go for anything now. Give me anything.
Absolutely. I also find when I started out, things used to bother me. You know, you'd sort of... When you're a young designer and there's a ceiling, you go, like, oh, there's a ceiling, I don't know what to do. Or there's a mirrors and I don't know what to do. Whereas now it's like, yeah, bring it on. You know, let's have it. Let's put a ceiling in. And we did that at an opera a few years ago where I think, and again, I hope there are no set designers in this conversation or watching us on replay, but I think the designer's brief to himself was, how can I make it as difficult for the lighting person as humanly possible? And they succeeded admirably, I have to say. The floor was a tilt and a rake. So it was a double that tilted and went off in a direction, which was a black and white chessboard, checker sort of dartboard spiral thing. The walls were green foliage wrapped around on three sides. There was a blue sky ceiling, and the archways that were open for entrances had mirror doors that came on in act two. I was like, yeah, cheers, thanks for that.
Yeah.
You know, but you just go, okay, well, that's what we've got to work with, and you know, let's just go for it.
Yeah, I think it's so funny what you said there, Prem, about the going for it and saying, you know, let's have the gloss, because the designer that you worked with on that, I had just done a Christmas show with. And she had said, oh, you know, we're going to do it in this black box. Everything's going to be floaty, floaty. It's going to be magic. And we kind of worked out that the venue didn't quite have enough to mask it. And I said, well, why don't we go the other way? Why don't we do gloss black floor? Because that hides a multitude of sins. And I remember her saying, I didn't know this was what it was at the time. And I remember her saying, do you know, I spent my whole career being told to avoid gloss things. Suddenly everybody wants things to be gloss. And I never realised that must have been the two things in parallel at the same time. That's quite funny.
So I get to blame you, Rory.
Yeah, exactly.
That's where the idea started.
I've got two questions that have come in here. One says, with colour mixing fixtures, do you tend to start with a gel colour base or mix a colour from scratch that isn't necessarily related to any specific gel? I presume this is in terms of like numbers. Do you start with 201 or do you just go, I want like a sort of bluey, steely thing?
I've started using the LED app to make a scroller list because, not the, the Lee app, to make a scroller list, because I find having a plan full of fixtures that I know what I want them to do but have no reference on the plan to what they're doing, particularly regarding to colour and the fact that I can have less of them because they're doing multiple colours, I need to have with me a list of colours that I've made and chosen for that show. I might throw it in the bin halfway through tech and I might not refer to it, but I go in with that colour list.
Yeah, that's a good idea. What about everyone else?
What I used to do, I've become slightly lazier in my dotage, but I particularly less so with LED, but more when we were in discharge world, is I would be quite consistent about the way I would sort of build up my colour palettes, in that I would only ever make effectively six color palettes, and there would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and it would always be CMYRGB. which are the full flags of each of the colors. And then I would break that down. So color palette 1.1 was 10% cyan, 1.2, 20% cyan, 1.3, 30% cyan, and so on and so on and so on. So I would end up with, I only have to remember 6 numbers, but you can then layer things in. So if I wanted to mix a pale green, I'd go, well, that's probably 30% cyan and 20% yellow. Thank you very much. There's my new color, and file that away in the bank. So that was how I used to sort of build up with discharge stuff. Mm. And again, that was pre any sort of fancy color picker stuff that, you know, exists on consoles and things like that. Now I'm quite happy just to mash console buttons and see what it throws out. And if it's right for the scene, store it. You know, it's a lot of decisions made now are made for time and efficiency more than anything else. So I would love to have the time to sit and take all 7 colors and mix my own version of 201. Do you know what? Someone else has done the hard work for me. I'll just mash the button and see what happens and then adjust from there.
Brilliant.
Rory, I think what we perhaps haven't touched on though is that relationship we have with programmers and actually how programmers are, of course, very creative, but it's really lovely. Part of my process is I very rarely shout out gel numbers. I mean, occasionally, yes, I do, but I tend to just sort of go, could you make me a pale straw? Could you make me a deeper straw? And then we work from that and a bit deeper. Yeah, let's say that as deep straw. Yeah. And then you get to deeper, deep straw and all those silly sort of labels. But there's something about that relationship between you and the person you're sat next to for 2 weeks and involving them into the process, and actually they do bring so much. So color in particular is great to kind of have that dialogue and create together.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And you find when you come back to working with the same programmers over and over again, don't you, you have such a shorthand. I mean, there's I work with a fantastic programmer, Jack, and our sort of code for the deepest blue in the LED is always labeled deep sexy blue, because that's exactly what it is. And so it doesn't matter where we are, what the unit is, I go, oh, you know what, I deep sexy blue is where I'm going with this. And so your programmer is absolutely your perfect person. And I'm aware of time, so I'm going to rattle through some of these other questions that have come through. Declan, how does it work when you're designing the set and lighting? Do you create sets that you know you can light in certain ways / colors?
You know what? I always thought that I, one of the advantages of doing set and light is that I would never put a set in, you know, with a ceiling or some, or walls or something that prevents me from being able to light it. Only to find that actually my instinct was design what the show needs and then deal with it afterwards from a lighting point of view. And I've put some stuff into venues and gone, how the hell am I going to light that? And I've got no one to blame but myself. Yeah. I mean, yes, I'm conscious of it. And a lot of my design decisions are informed by how I think it might be lit, particularly in terms of choice of color and choice of materials. But it's a fine line to walk, because you don't want to shoot yourself in the foot as the LD, but you also don't want to not create the world that needs to be there. I mean, one thing I think was a great fusion of my lighting influence affecting my set design. We did a sister act quite a few years ago now, and I still don't know how I managed to convince the producer that this is what we needed to do. But the rose window for the church was made up of 87 LED moving heads that we then pixel mapped to make the road to make the stained glass window. And of course, it looked like the sun was streaming through, because in the haze, of course, you get these. But it was in the show for 15 minutes. How I convinced them to spend that money on 87 fixtures that was in the show for how many minutes, I don't know. But it was fabulous. But that was very much my lighting hat, wanting to go, I don't just want a stained glass window that I can put a parkhand through. Let's do something. Yeah. I don't think I've answered the question at all, but it's a fine line to walk.
Yeah. That's all right. I mean, you've floored us with that. I mean, I'm that's baffled me. A question here, Joe, I'm going to aim at you. One color that you couldn't live without, what would it be?
Oh,
There's a quick fire in a minute, so the rest of you need to stop them. Say that again.
197.
Brilliant. Prema, this one's for you. I follow Spotted on Fame when it was at the Troubadour in January. Colour played a huge part in that show, especially with the amount of colour in the lighting strips on the massive book-like structure that was the set. Was that a collaborative decision between you and the set designer?
Well, firstly, thank you for follow spotting on that show. Amazing, that's exciting. Yeah, I think Morgan was very clear about wanting to use lights in the set, and he's very collaborative in that way. And I think I was quite led to wanting options. You know, very early on, white card, you want to keep your options open. So for me, yes, of course, it was about budgets, and you can imagine how those conversations went. But at that stage, it was all about as much flexibility as was possible. So I think we had like 183 light boxes. Oh, golly. And just the flexibility of making sure we had control over each one gave me scope during the rehearsal process to really go to town and, just really have all my options open. Has that answered the question? I've just got so excited about the fact that someone's worked on a show in Follow Spotted. That's quite exciting. I got distracted.
That was exactly it. And I think, can we not all watch it this weekend, I think? Have I not just seen that it's...
Well, there's a debate behind that. I think the creators were the last to know. We found out yesterday. So I don't know if it's happening, Rory. That's the inside bit of information.
Good. Glad I touched on that. Listen, we're rapidly running out of time, and it's been great. I mean, we could literally talk for hours on all of this. But what I've been doing with everyone is like a 5 quick fire questions in a round that I'm lovingly calling Before You Go. So I'm going to ask you them. We'll go just because of the way it's on my screen, Declan, Prema, Joe, and we'll rattle through them and see where we get to. So something that you would put on every plan if you could, maybe for flexibility.
Ooh. a good set of LED somethings.
Okay, great. Prema.
Oh, no, I don't even know how to answer this question. I feel panicked. A really decent straw.
Nice. Joe.
I always try and put some LED on every plan I now do, whether it's from a fringe venue to a musical.
Okay. Your favourite pre-preview meal?
Something that you love to eat in previews. Yeah, it's a Burger King, I'm afraid. It's just greasy and it's junky and it's normally by that point of tech, I just want junk food.
I hope you wear the crown all through the preview as well.
Of course, goes without saying. Yeah.
Prema, what about you?
I'm not sure if we even get time to have the pre-dinner, but I just quickly need to fess up and say often I creep in with my lunch, you know, before dress rehearsal. So I was at Story House a couple of years ago, brought my lunch in, and completely idiotic of me, completely forgot about the confetti drop at the end of Act One. So I'm sat there trying to eat my lunch and I can just see snow falling into my lunch. And so that's a lesson for me about food and techs and, yeah, just generally don't eat. That's the answer. No, it's not. It's not.
Brilliant. Joe, what about you?
Wagamamas. It's fast, quick, and it makes me think that I've actually had a healthy production week, and I haven't.
One piece of advice that you would give yourself 5 years ago, because I don't want to do the whole, like, you'd give your just your younger self 5 years ago, if you could go back and give yourself one piece of advice, what would it be?
I'm not sure about the answer to that, but I don't think any of us would have got the answer right. Where do you see yourselves in 5 years' time?
Exactly. Yeah. go on. Do you have anything, or will I move on to Prema?
No, not really.
Keep using green. Just keep
going. Yeah, just be brave and be green.
Brilliant. Prema, what about you?
I remember thinking that there's this funny way of all the networks coming together. So you suddenly light a show for one person and they know so-and-so and it leads to the next job. So I suddenly went from a moment of panicking about not having any work to suddenly everything fitting so beautifully. And how brilliant that our industry is so well connected together, actually. So take comfort in that, I think.
Yeah, that's great. Joe, what about you?
Oh, it's a tricky question, isn't it? I'm going to be very practical, I think. I wish that I had kept contact details better for everybody that I've worked with, especially now, because there's more people I'd like to be in touch with and I can't because I don't know how to be in touch with them. But yeah, I wish I'd kept better paperwork and emails and phone numbers of everybody I've worked with.
Something that you wish you had at a production desk that you just never do.
Comfy seats.
Yes, comfy seats. Very true. Yeah. Prema.
I'm renowned for being really awful at not having pens. I'd get a flap and end up stealing the stage manager's pens, and it's the most basic thing, but you know. Lighting the show is big enough. So pens, I would love to have pens.
I love it. Brilliant. Joe, what about you?
I want my own lighting desk that doesn't disturb the programmer.
Oh, okay. And my final question to all of you, if you had to write an autobiography right now, what would the title be?
What? An opera?
An autobiography.
Oh, an autobiography. I mean,
you can also answer that as well. That'd be great. That's a hard one. I appreciate that. But I've asked everyone this. I'm interested to see what everyone comes up with.
I'll go with Making the Light Fantastic.
Oh, nice.
I hate going after Declan. Declan, I'm never going to sit on a panel with you again. mine is going to have to be a cliche thing of, obviously, be the change you want to see.
Nice, I like it, yeah. Joe, round us off. What is your autobiography?
Life in the Jet Stream.
Oh, very good. Very good.
I don't know, my middle name is Elizabeth, so my nickname is Jet.
That's brilliant. Listen, thank you all so much for this. It's been so lovely to speak to you all, and it's great to hear what we all have in common and what we all do differently, and it's just so nice to hear other people's processes. So thank you so much for all your time, and I hope we can do a similar thing soon.
Brilliant. Thank you, Rory.
No problems. Thank you.
It's been great to have you all.